I heard it said the best by Jensen Franklin. He said, I would hate to think that the enemy spends more time pursuing the presence of God to accuse you than we spend to be in the presence of God. Jesus says himself in John 8 that the devil's native tongue is to lie. So we have to be careful. Who are we placing as our father? And we left off speaking about John 5 and 31, about the fourfold witness. And we read that it said that Jesus said that he himself would not be a true witness. And I've never heard any scripture where Jesus speaks of him not being of any, of not having truth of anything, on anything at all. So it kind of stuck with me. And then when reading further into John through this week, I read into John 8, Jesus defends himself of his self-witness. And it says on 13, John 8, 13, the Pharisees therefore said to him, you bear witness of yourself, your witness is not true. Jesus answered said to them, even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true. So did we not just read in John 5, 31, the fourfold witness, where it said, if I bear witness of myself, this is Jesus speaking, my witness is not true. There is another who bears witness of me, and I know the witness which he, capital H, witnesses of me is true. So I went to the Greek text with this verse, and it says, if I witness concerning myself, then my witness is not true. It is another who witnesses concerning me. So they use the word concern. And concern just means all about. And that's one thing Jesus doesn't do. He doesn't make anything all about him. It's always about his father. He would share the scriptures in time. When he needed something, he would go to the scripture. He did not say, I myself say. He read the word of his father. He has never been about himself. He never brings honor unto himself. He always points to the Father. You know, myself means an own initiative or own sake. He has never been about his own sake. He was of the will of his Father. So you can see how in the verse where he said, my witness is not true, he was actually saying, me, myself, as in my own person here, not of me, the Christ who sits with God, who God is always with me. When you understand who God is and who Jesus is, how they are one, how God is always with him and that he never left him. And the only time that he ever had to leave Jesus was the moment on the cross where the sky darkened, where the veil ripped, and he cried out in that weak moment of being alone, of being himself alone. In 2 John 8, when he says, you bear witness of yourself, your witness is not true. Then Jesus answered and said to him, even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true. For I know where I come from and I know where I'm going, but you do not know. You judge according to the flesh. So this is Jesus telling them that it is God who is with me. I am the Son of God. I go to my Father. I'm here to do my Father's work. It is not him by myself. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am the one who bears witness of myself, and my Father who sent me bears witness of me. Then they said to him, where is your Father? And then he says, you know neither me or my Father. And Jesus says, if I honor myself, myself, my honor is nothing. Because you see, he always points to the Father. He who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him. And then if you go in to the Abraham's seed and Satan, it says, I know that you are Abraham's descendants. This is Jesus talking to the Pharisees. You seek to kill me, but because my words have no place in you, I speak what I have seen with the Father, and you do what you have seen with your father. And they answered him and said, Abraham is our father. And he said, Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's child, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I hear from God. Abraham did not do this. You do the deeds of your father. He's just saying, you're doing the deeds of Satan. He is the father of murder. He is the father of lie. Then they said to him, we were not born for fornication. We have one father, one God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God, nor have I come of myself. But he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my words. You are the father of the devil, and the desire of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. But because I tell you the truth, you do not believe me. Which of you convicts me of sin? And if I tell you truth, why do you not believe me? He who is of God hears God's words. Therefore, you do not hear because you are not of God. Before Abraham was, I am. Of whom you say that he is your God, yet you have not known him. But I know him. And if I say I do not know him, I shall be a liar like you. But I do know him and keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. But Jesus says in scripture, Abraham was excited for me to come. Abraham spoke of me. Moses spoke of me. They were excited for me to come. They were awaiting my arrival because they knew who my father was. And you do not know who my father is. That's why as I speak to you, you do not understand the words, because you do not understand the light, because you are a son of Satan. That is your father, is the father of evil deeds, who has no light in him. So the Lord wants this to be very clear. He wants his witness to be very clear in this darkest time of the year. He wants his light to be true. He wants his witness to be true. Who he is, why he came, and what he is doing at coming for us. What he does, it fulfills the will of his Father, which is the food of Jesus. He says, That is my food, to do my Father's will and to finish. His witness was his duty, was the will of his Father. That was a true witness of what he was doing. Part of that fourfold, let's go back into the fourfold again. The fourfold witness. Who are these four witnesses? Jesus saying that he can bear witness of himself because his Father is with him. God himself being a witness. 33, it says, you have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth. He was a burning and shining lamp, and you were willing for a time to rejoice in his light. But I have a greater witness than John's. For the works which the Father has given me to finish, that is a witness. The very works that I do bear witness of me. His works and the signs that he showed, those true times of wonders. This is not false wonders, which will come in the last days of the false prophets, of the false Messiah. John 3:14 says, just how Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, this is how the Son of Man must be lifted up. And for all those who believe, they will have eternal life. That he, you know, there is a big difference between law in love, and Jesus is love. Jesus is the embodiment of love. Love is only of the light. It only comes from the Father of light. And love does not come from darkness. As I sat and watched our President Biden speak about love as he's signing documents for same-sex marriage, Biden made a comment saying, "This is what's best for the soul of the Americans. This is not what's best for the soul of the Americans. Your father is not my father. You do not know my father. For if you knew my father, you would not be saying these things." It says, he said that love beats hate. But there is a time where we take love to the wrong level, to a next level, where it becomes perversion and it goes against the will of God. So our love can be there. Our love for one another can be there. But where do we take those levels to? Biden made a comment at the end of his speech saying, "God protect the troops. Now let me sign." And let me just say, there is not protection that's going to come from that being signed. They kept saying through this meeting that this was going to be a time of protection. This was a protection of marriage. And it's not going to protect, it's going to send harm to our nations because of the wrath of God is going to hit on the United States. Whether you like it, whether you believe it, it's just the facts. It's just how God rolls. He punishes those when you walk in darkness and when you take his morals and you don't care and you want to call them wrong and you're calling what is wrong right. It is right to love. It is right to love one another. There's consequences to our actions, and it sounds great. It sounds great. Love everybody. I mean, he kept making comments that it was hateful not to let other people marry each other, not let love win. And that's not a sign of hate. I'm actually more concerned on how God is going to judge the people. I'm more concerned for the people on how, you know, everything's going to go. We have to look at past history and what has happened. And we see when the angels came down and laid with human, we had a flood. We see what happened at Babylon. And in this last days, the darkness will claim to be truth, will claim to be love. It will claim to be something that is right and that we should be doing all along, that the world should come together and love one another in unity and no matter what. And they'll do it in their own form. John 7:7, "The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify of it and the deeds of evil that it does." So the world is never going to like Jesus. Sorry, it's not gonna happen. There's always gonna be that chaos that happens. The Lord did not come to be peaceful. He came to do the will of his Father, and he knew that was going to shake things up. He lives in peace. He is a form of peace. That is him. That is who he is. So when you worship him, when you speak to him, you will feel peace. For those who believe, you know, no condemnation, peace will be on you. But many will not. Many will not believe. John 3, that he who believes is not condemned. But those who do not believe are condemned already. That because when the light came to the earth, they did not believe because they chose darkness. They'd rather be living in their evil deeds. There is a freedom that comes. Let's go to John 8:31. It says, Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." There is truth, there is light. When you understand who your father is, you know, you think that your father is of Abraham, you think that your father is God, but your father is Satan, your father is the father of lies, and you are under a deception is what the one message that I'm trying to put forth is, who is your father? send honor to God and thank Him for sending that gift of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for doing that for us. You know, take that time out. Take some time out under those stars and get into that real spirit of that nativity, because that's what this time is about. And it's so strong right now. I don't know if it's because of the date, but it just seems so strong this year. The date being having Hanukkah at the same time as Christmas. It's actually going to be one of the days of Hanukkah as Christmas. This year, it's Hanukkah starts on the 18th. So that's exciting, but it goes on until Christmas time. So maybe that has something to do with it. Who knows? But I love spending that time giving Him honor, you know, giving God honor for what He has done, what He has sent us. So make sure you spend that time, because this part of the year is about Him. So in this time when heaven and earth collides, be in the spirit of Christmas, of Jesus, of Jesus's birth, of Jesus's conceiving. Don't forget who He is, what He has came for, that He has sent His true witnesses for you, so you will know that He is the true Messiah. We look forward to seeing you guys next time, and remember to dive deep into the things of God.